Hi everyone, it's Jerry. This is the game between Garry Kasparov, playing on the white end, against Lajos Portisch. This was from the Niksic Tournament of 1983. This tournament consisted of 15 players, a few former world champions competing, Mikhail Tal, Tigran Petrosian, and Boris Spassky. So let's dive into this round 4 game and see what makes it one of the greats. Kasparov opening with d4. We have a Queen's Indian defense. And this little move, a3, designed to preserve the knight and ultimately throw a punch at the queen bishop. May sound odd, but there is this idea to play d5 and then e4 next, and the bishop is effectively biting on a rock. So black sees this, playing d5 himself. C takes. Black is recapturing with a piece, keeping open the long diagonal. White has a central majority, but cannot yet set it into motion. That would drop a pawn. Knight takes, B takes. White inserts a check. Ultimately, the bishop will be best placed on d3, but why not throw in this check and see if you can provoke a poor move? There's only one good reply here, and it's the game move, c6. Doing otherwise, a knight block allows white to pounce, and if the bishop goes to c6, white can say, aha, your c-pawn can't move to c5 so easily. You'll have to waste some time. So, c6, bishop d3, and only then c5. So in the end, we basically have a position that we would have had if the bishop went to d3 straight away. Castles, knight c6. For the moment, this diagonal is not opened, but his eyes will be opened up soon enough. Queen to e2, rook to d1, the queen gets out of the line of fire, and here we go. White can go forward with e4, setting the central majority into motion, or another option. Kasparov tries c4. This is, white is welcome to a hanging pawn structure with this advance. That's what we have soon enough. And right now, white is just one moment away from having this bishop see the heart of the kingside structure directly. I want to draw some attention to this because if you're playing on the black side, you may already be saying to yourself, you know what, that bishop on b2 is going to be really strong. Maybe I should look to offset him by playing bishop to f6. This would be faulty. Let's see why. If bishop to f6, white would have d5. Bishop takes bishop, loses a piece to pawn takes knight. And if knight to e5, white has this little tactic, capturing on h7, and then recapturing white's up a pawn. So in short, you cannot look to negate the bishop on b2 with bishop to f6 at this moment. In the game, c takes d4, e takes, and white has now the hanging pawn structure. Knight to a5 clears the way, gets out of the bishop's way and major piece's way. c4 is now a focal point. Struck at multiple times, 3 times, only defended twice. White ignores this, though. Pressing forward with d5, opening this guy's eyes up. And, you can't take on c4. There's some issue with that. In the game, we had e takes d5. Taking on c4 allows queen to e4, provoking g6. And then, queen to e5, looking for mate. White is in the driver's seat from here. So, in the game, it was e takes d5, c takes d5, bishop takes d5, and now the first of two bishop sacrifices, snipping on h7. Not a true sacrifice, as you are getting that material right back. Rook takes bishop. King to g8, and Yeah, that's sensible, because you're just on a completely open diagonal. Multiple checks are in the air, right? Four different checks, five different ones. Not that queen to c2 is the greatest. You get the idea. The king does better on g8. Playing to c2 allows queen to e5, and this is a big issue for black. Threatening mate, queen to h5 ideas. So king to g8 is played, and now we have the second of two sacrifices. Bishop takes g7. A double bishop sack, and king takes bishop, of course. What was interesting to me is learning that Kasparov did not consider bishop takes g7 as a sacrifice. He viewed it as an exchange of pieces. He saw the g7 pawn, in other words, as extremely valuable to black. Without it, the black king is forever without a home. With the queen still on the board, you can be sure that the black king will be in trouble. Moreover, if we consider, after this sacrifice, the knight positions, whose knight stands better? It's clearly white's knight, who next plays into e5. The knight is far away from the action. That's what we have. Knight to e5, paving the way for potentially rook d7 move, and also queen to g4. Rook on f to d8 is played, challenging the rook and opening up a new square for the king. Queen g4, king f8. White is now inching a little bit closer to the king, threatening mate on f7. Black defends with f6. Defending with bishop to d6, gives up the f6 square to the queen. White would be able to inch one step closer. Multiple ideas in mind. Queen to h8, knight to g6 with queen to h8 ideas. And if bishop takes knight, how are you defending the mate threat? Queen to h8, or even the idea of swinging the rook in to h8. You're not. Best is to give up your queen at that point. So bishop to d6 was not played. f6. Knight to d7 follows. This knight must be captured, and is, with rook takes knight. If the king tries to run, he is going to run into some serious trouble going towards the center. That's a nice little mate. So he's intolerable, is the short story. Rook takes knight. Rook takes rook. And black says, can we have a queen exchange? White says, no way. Your king is much more weak. Queen to h7, rook to c7, and now we have a very important moment in the game, actually. And I'll throw a little pop quiz to you. What would you play as white in this position? If you'd like to, go ahead, pause the video. White to move, what would you do? Okay, white plays the move queen to h8. This is an extremely important move because, you know, if you want to keep this rook around and play into d3 instead, there's a big issue with this move. Okay, what's the issue? Here's another pop quiz if you'd like. What would black do if you played the move rook to d3 here? Okay, black would have this wonderful tactic of capturing on f2. It's an impressive move. If rook takes queen, that's going to run into mate. Yeah, the tides turn. And queen after rook to d3, queen takes f2. If the king takes, now we have this check. And then rook takes queen, and black is out of the woods. The game continues with this imbalance, but yeah, without the queens on the board, black's king isn't shaking so much. So you have to anticipate this little tactical shot and first play queen to h8, get the queen out of the line of fire, and only then play your rook to d3. So it's easy to get caught up into this attack, which is what white has been doing since move what? Seems like move 17. Move 19. Yeah. You have to anticipate your opponent's threats there, and there was a... That would have been a cold shower, for sure. Following up, we have knight to c4. Rook to d1, getting the last piece involved. And knight to e5. Black should not be thinking about winning material. This is not working. Going here, runs into mate. Going here, will be running into mate soon enough. Could block in a few different ways, but who cares? Rook to d8 next is mate. And so, what else if here? You could give checks. Okay, in short, this knight should not be looking to grab material. Knight to e5, hoping to secure some key squares around the king, hoping to defend. A little punch is thrown, but now this game finishes up very nicely with a little king walk to finish. Queen h7, dropping back to these squares results into that same tactical sequence I already highlighted. So the game move, king e6, queen g8, king f5, g4. If knight takes pawn, rook f3, and then queen takes knight, leading to mate, eventually. Here, here, mate and two right around the corner. The game move, king to f4, rook to d4, king to f3, and one last move, queen to b3, and the black king has had enough. Black throwing in the towel at this point. No good move here. If queen block, we would have check, check, and checkmate. But that's as far as it went. A nice little king walk here to end. Double bishop sack. A little king walk to end this one. And yeah, a really nice finish for sure. Very, very direct play. So, as usual, feel free to leave any feedback to this video in the comment section below, and I'll catch you soon. That's all for now. Take care. Bye.